I'll present some of our work and some of the consequences we have had doing publication and trying to make material more open access. And it has to be turned on. That's better. Just a short agenda. I'll need to tell you what we're doing at Tidsskrift.dk, which is journal.dk in English. Then I'll tell you a bit about how much is open access. And I need to tell you a bit about development of the server, because else you won't understand why the profile is as it is. Tell you about the present status, and then go to the results and experiences, and I'll end up with something about why a platform like Tidsskrift.dk is necessary, at least due to open access. I need you to bear in mind that I'm talking from a Danish perspective. 5 million people are talking our language. It's not English, it's not Chinese, it's not Spanish. So we have local issues, if I may say it like this. But right now we're having 152 publications. 151 of them are public available. Mostly from social science and humanities. Science authors and health authors in Denmark publish in international journals. Mostly is of course in Danish, a lot in English, something in Norwegian and Swedish. We have Nordic journals, and two of them publish in Spanish actually. And our requirements are, you need to be a Danish scientific publication, you need to have open access, or at least open access with a green open access if you have an embargo. And you must publish on the server. We do not have situations where you can use a system to edit your journal but not publishing it. Too much work for us. And I need to count something before I came here. 108 are active. 33 are what I would call retrodigitized, either old newspapers that have closed down, or earlier versions of existing journals. Every journal has its own instance, even if it's perished, in order to make sure the metadata is correct. Then six have moved. Actually, two of them have moved to professional providers, so we get some quality out of it. And four of them moved to Aalborg, because we helped them to start their OJS server, so we let their journal start on ours. And then, if you count that together, there's a handful I need to ask. What are you doing? Perhaps they have stopped. We need to check up. And what it really makes me proud is that 22 of the publications were born on the server. They published the first issue there, all of them open access, which is quite important to have new scientific fields being able to publish somewhere. Now, open access, it's a national open access platform. Well, nearly all the journals do have immediate open access. Few have a one-year embargo, and then we have two with five-year embargoes. These two journals are old friends. They came in the young wild years, and we didn't want to put any pressure on them later on. They've been with us for better and worse, so they have some rights. And then we have one experimental, which is only available if you attend a certain conference. History, we started with two servers. The Royal Danish Library is a merger between the State University Library and the Royal Danish Library. We had one in Aarhus and one in Copenhagen. And in 2015, the server in Copenhagen became the national open access platform. They got a grant from something called DEF and also from the Ministry of Research. Then in 16, we discussed whether we should upgrade, but we ran into problems with the subscription plugin. There was no subscription. And then in 2017, the two libraries merged and the two servers merged. And then in 18, we did upgrade. I'm actually quite happy that we followed this scheme, because it made it easier for us to do the upgrade and the merger. Now, the sources of publications are about the same for the two servers. In Copenhagen and Aarhus, we had from the universities. We took in from scientific societies, and then from journals within the culture, Ministry of Culture. And that's because the Royal Library is part of that, so it would be a bit awkward not to take in journals from that area after all they're paying for the whole thing. And then we have taken in from university colleges, and Copenhagen had a project with retrodigitization of old journals, which was quite interesting. They made a workflow where we could import the files directly from the scanner. We've been growing every year. We had the wild years in 16 and 17. The people in Copenhagen, being the national open access platform, got in a lot of journals. Lately, it's been a bit quiet, but it's okay for me. We have 6 or 7 more in the workflow in the pipeline, but it takes time for the journal to come online. Downloads? Well, both servers did count, but we did count in different ways. So after the merger, these are the data, 2.2 million downloads of the articles in 17, and mark that is from the summer until winter. We merged in July. Then in the year of the upgrade, we had 3.5 million, and we hope to have more than 4 million. And all the journals are being read, even the dead ones. Some of the old journals that were versions before the new journals, researchers that were young and wild when they wrote the articles are now old and big, and if you track down their work, you'll find it on our server in the old issues. What is important, and actually more important than figures, we are a platform provider. We give courses. First, we have initial meeting to see whether the journal really has some requirements we can't fulfill. And then we have an introductory course where we give them homework. They have to prepare data to put on this journal. When the first course is finished, we finish with a quick submit, so that actually they would be able to publish the first issue. And a couple of times we started the course, 3 hours later, you had a first issue of a journal out. That is very nice when you do work like that. Then we have had an entire workflow course. About half of our journals are quick submit journals, half use the entire workflow. And we think the number will be growing because of OJS3. Then we have a little support. We ask them, please send us mails, do not call us, because then we can handle our workload a bit better. And we try to make something called OJS på dansk, OJS in Danish, where we put out help files so that we can just tell them, go to this article and find information there. Then, of course, we help them with DOIs, registering all over, and we give a lot of advice. Open access, DOAJ, copyright issues, GDPR as a new thing, and it takes a lot of time. We were discussing whether we should do it or not, but we would feel awkward if we didn't, because the journals need that kind of information. But we do not do all the publisher things. We do not make any kind of public relation. Actually, we haven't made much for the server as such. The journals were coming by themselves. We do not scan old articles. We do not design home pages. They get the basic view, and that's it. We do not do typesetting, administration, and we do not help them with the editorial workflow. That is, we do not find reviews and stuff like that. Because if we started to do that, we would need to charge money for what we're doing. Essential, the server right now is free for the journals. I'm not sure that economic way is going to keep on, but right now it's essential free for the journals. What have we learned? Well, we made it possible for Danish journals to survive. 200 subscribers. You can't go to Elsevier and say, would you do something for us with such a small publishing line? So we made them survive. We made old articles open access. And we realized that many of the journals that are using subscription are mostly doing that in order to pay for the printed issue. It's not because they do anything else with it, which is a bit strange. And then we see that the editors have a lot of problems understanding what happens when you go online. Even today, even the young people that should be more informed. But the play with subscriptions, open access, copyright, licensing, this thing that open access is just about getting the file online. There's more to it. And if you start to say, well, you can improve your economy by using APCs, they look at us as we've been saying something naughty. I mean, we're not talking about taking €1,000, but perhaps just 200, so they could get some money in. But we can't sell it. Anyway, We see that they change to immediate open access when they realize that they don't need the printed version. New journals are coming here, and especially a new genre in Denmark, the student journal, where you take an essay, ask the student to write an article, and then it is published. And all this could only be done in dialogue with the users, with our good friends from PKP, with the Danish OJS network, the Swedish OJS network, and our good friend in Finland, you see. And we need that to improve our services. And then we realized something. Most of the Nordic OJS servers are run by research libraries. It seems to be the natural place to start a service like that. There's a bit difference between Sweden, Norway, and Denmark, but mostly they are run by research libraries. So it's good friends, we can talk together. And I think I'm keeping time, my last slide. Why is this service necessary? Remember, this is from a Danish perspective. Small country, 5 million people. Elsevier don't care. We are too small, we will never be able to bring enough money. The two journals that moved, one of them moved to a small journal publisher in Germany, the other to a rather big international publisher, but they had money with them from society and could pay. They are not getting any income from subscriptions because they need to be open access. And they don't charge APCs because that's not a tradition we have. So no income, but they still have costs, yes. Typesetting, layouts, administration. So they get dependent on funding, and there's not enough funding in Denmark going around you can apply for. So they need a service like ours. And I think that must be the same in many other countries, at least if you come from a small language area. Norway, at least I know. And that was what I had to say.
Thank you, Jesper.
Thank you.